Introducing Video Assist 2.0. This is the biggest update ever to Video Assist. Today I'm going to run you through all of the new features, so let's get into it. First of all, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about my setup. I've got a Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 4K here, which is connected to my Teradek 4K. It's transmitting the picture wirelessly to my iPad rig. This iPad rig is running an iPad Pro M4, and it's running Video Assist 2.0. I'm going to have a little bit more to say about the rig later on in this video. So let's get into the new features. First of all, I want to show you pinch to zoom. This is self-explanatory. You pinch on the image and it zooms. You can pinch in and drag around just to check out everything closer. What is super handy is for directors, if you've got a shot like this, which I recorded earlier on in the garden, and you're using a frame line to sort of say, hey, that's our shot. A director might just go, oh, and so how about we just go in for a tight like that? Really helpful. And this also works in full screen mode. So if you're in full screen mode, you can pinch to zoom. And down here in the corner, it will show you what percentage of magnification zoom you're in. You can actually zoom all the way into 10 times magnification and pan around. The next feature I want to show you is the sidebar. So I'm going to go back to our normal view. Traditionally in Video Assist, you tap and hold and you can open up your tools here to adjust some of the settings. Some of the new features that I've built benefit from a little bit more space in the user interface to interact with a lot of these tools. So now on any of the tools along here, you can tap these three dots and select Move to Sidebar. Now your tool shows here in the sidebar. If you enable it, you've got the mask, and then you can scale the mask, you can pan and scan the mask, you can move it up and down, you can change the aspect ratio, and that can be easier to do here rather than with an overlay like that, as it allows you to see the image that you're working with and your tools at the same time. With the sidebar, you can also go options and select show all tools, and this is going to show you all of the tools here all at once. So, you know, you might want to go in and modify your grid, and then you may also want to rotate the image, and you can do all that here, all in one. For now, I'm going to select options and I'm going to close the sidebar, and I'm going to flick off the mask because that is not required for what I'm about to show you. I'll press stop to go back to a live image, and this is the feed directly from the Blackmagic camera. One of the biggest changes to Video Assist 2.0 is that the live image and the playback image has now been moved to use Apple's Metal framework. This opens up a number of new features. The first one I want to show you is LUTs. So if I just move the color tool to the sidebar, I've now got my live image and the color tool. If I select LUT, I can scroll down and select a Log C to Rec 709 LUT, and it's applied there. I've also got this really cool LUT Mix feature, which lets you dial in the percentage the LUT is applied. So if it's at 0%, that's just the image coming from camera. If it's at 100%, it's got the full LUT applied, and you can do anything in between. You can select through a number of different LUTs. I've got a few loaded on here just for tests. And the LUTs are in combination with your normal color tools, where you can change brightness and contrast and saturation and add a bit of red and pull out a bit of blue, green, change the warmth, and you can tint it. And like normal, this can all be toggled off and on simply like that. If I hit reset all, it resets back to zero. If I reapply a LUT, I can just toggle the LUT off and on down here. So I'm going to tap up here and remove from sidebar, go back to my normal view. The next thing I want to show you is monitor tools. So this is down here. And you've got three sets of tools in this mix. You've got focus peaking, false color, and zebras. I'm going to move it to the sidebar again just to show you how it works. So with focus peaking, I can enable, and it's going to give you some red focus peaking for the time being. And you can kind of see in here that it's applying, showing the sharp areas of the image. This can be changed to a number of different colors. You can also make the background black and white if you just want to see the color. You can change from color to luminance, which is traditionally what you would call peaking in other different softwares. In peaking, you can change how much the luminance boosts. And then you can also change the intensity of the peaking. So you'll see this here on the whole image. And this applies for the color as well. That's basically the sensitivity of your peaking there. I've also added a softening feature, which this kind of feathers the edging of the peaking. So you can see that it sort of softens off there if that's kind of to your preference. The next thing I want to show you is false color. So if you select false color, you've got an indication of the exposure and it's using ARRI false color. So a number of DPs quite like just being able to toggle that off and on and use that as an exposure reference. And you can tap here to change to view the red false color, and you can also use the Atomos false color. Another thing we've introduced with the new metal-backed image pipeline is zebras. So if you go into zebras, you're going to see your exposure. So we've kind of got our high zebra set to 95%, but if we bring that down to say 75 or 70%, you will see that there, everything that's exposed at 70%. If you can't quite get 70% exact, you can of course pop in your exact percentage via the numeric input. You can also change the colors of the high-end zebras. And if you want low-end zebras, you can also do that too. So for anything that's underexposed, it's kind of going to show there. And you can pull up and say, oh, anything that's under 10% exposed, it's going to show red. And anything that's over 70%, it's going to show yellow, or we'll make it green. So they're the three kind of tools that we've got: focus peaking, false color, and zebras. I'm going to remove that from sidebar and just disable it now. Now, one of the really cool new features that I'm excited to show you is compositing. Now, this is very cool. So I'm going to start. I'll go into here, and there was a few shots that I recorded before to help demo this. So I'm going to load up this one. And as you can see, it's just me walking there. And then I've got another version, which is me just popping up and talking. So I'm going to leave this one loaded up here where you can kind of see me standing. This is the compositing tool. So I'll tap and hold and I'm going to move it to the sidebar. This is a really good place to work with compositing. So one thing you can do is you can go image and you can load an image from file or from the project. If I select from file, it lets me load up things like an overlay. So here I've got a red rectangle overlay. And I can just dial in the percentage to change its opacity. And I can also change through different blend modes, which are your normal kind of blend modes that you'll know from an app like Photoshop or something similar. Within here, if you're doing a logo, you can select transform, and then you're able to rotate the logo. You can scale the logo up, and then you can pan and scan it to position it on the screen. So this is really useful if you've got a client logo and you want to preview it with either your playback or your live image. You can also load images from a project. So if you select project, it's going to show you all of your frame grabs from this project here. So if I load it up, this is flowers, then I've basically got an overlay. If I change the mix here, it's an overlay between my live image and the flowers. Live image and the flowers. If I set it to 50%, I can use this wipe to do a wipe, and I can also rotate this to basically select my angle. And if I want to feather it, I can feather off that wipe, and then I can basically, you know, wipe with a feather. I could change my wipe angle. I'm going to just harden up the edge for a second, and I'm going to change it to an angle. And then I can basically wipe along an angle with it feathered. I could change it to 100% opacity and then basically just do a wipe like that. It allows me to kind of preview the image, which is really cool. Down here, you've got invert. So if I press invert, it's basically just going to switch it so you can quickly toggle between. All of the things you can composite using an image, you can also do with a video. So I'm going to just reset. I'm going to go playback and I'm going to just jump over to 3:1 here. And then I'm going to tap video, I'm going to select video, and I'm going to go from project. And I'm going to load up 3:2. So we can basically see we've got our composite. So if I blend between here and there, you're not going to see much of a difference because it's not wildly obvious. But if I pull this to around the middle, and then I pull this video to around the middle, I can see here I've got my video laid up, and then I can blend and I've got my other video laid up. So it's really cool that you can kind of do that just to do a little mix and sort of see where everything's going for these sort of advanced comps. If I set it to full, I can wipe. So I could basically just wipe across and just say, I want to see both in full. And then if you find that the edge is a little bit hard, say there, you can not rotate it, but we'll feather it. So then you can blend it there and get very close to a normal comp. So while this is happening, I could hit play there and I can kind of just scrub through and just sort of see the action there. And you've just done a comp, and it's really good. You can do that with playback, or if I hit stop, it's going to comp with live. I'm going to tap playback again to jump back in here and scroll across. And another thing you can do here, so I've got obviously got my video in the foreground, but video can be transformed as well. So I could scale myself up, or I could pan and scan myself and move it in and out. I could flip and flop. So you've got all these sorts of options just to tweak the image on both your foreground and your background. And of course, as before, you can invert it. So you're going to basically invert your world there. That'll look better when that's kind of like that. So yeah, these are the advanced compositing tools that are built into Video Assist. Makes it super easy to line things up on set if you're doing kind of match shots or anything VFX related. Super helpful. The next thing I want to show you is some improvements to our recording pipeline. So if you tap settings up here, you've basically got a few new options in terms of video format and audio format. So you can now record in H.265 and H.264 as you could before, but you've also got a few different flavors of ProRes. So you could select ProRes 422 and it's going to record in ProRes 422. You've got also new audio codecs. So before we used to just record in AAC. Now you can record in linear PCM as well in 16-bit or 24-bit. And you can also change the audio sample rate if you so desire. If you're shooting ProRes, you've got the options of proxy, LT, normal, and HQ. And if you're going with H.265 or H.264, you've got new options for video bitrate. So you can select auto, and basically the algorithm in Video Assist is going to pick the best bitrate based on your resolution. You can also select custom, and then you can dial in any sort of specific bitrate that you would like. And you can also change between MOV and MP4. The other options is none, and this basically lets the system do it for you. So this little pop-up here will explain exactly what the video bitrates do. But for now, I'm just going to revert back to AAC 44100, and a HVAC auto is good for me. Another really cool thing that I want to show you is input calibration. So you can see it down here, we've got calibration and LUTs. So input calibration I currently have enabled, and if I tap that, it's going to pop up here and it's going to show me my live image and my calibration. So if I toggle that off and on, you'll see a color shift in the image. Essentially what happens is many USB capture cards introduce a slight color shift to the image, particularly cheaper HDMI capture cards. So this is a way to apply a global color correction to your entire image feed. So if I just made this quite bright for a second and added a purple tint, that's going to apply to our live image, and when I playback, it's going to apply to all of our playback images. It's also going to apply if I open up here and I've got all my video previews, I can see that calibration is applied there. If I do any comping, so if I just reset that, go video, load up a video from the project, they're all going to show with that color tint on there, and when I load it in here, it's going to show tinted in the comp. So basically this is a global way to apply color correction, and that's designed to correct for inconsistencies in lower end capture cards. So I'm going to revert that and revert that. And this is actually a calibration that I've completed myself. So I can go off and on. Off, you can see it's quite a bit green, and I'm using that actually, ironically, the U-Green capture card, and it makes the image with a slight green tint, which has been reported by quite a few film crew that are using this as their input. So I'm going to leave that enabled, and now I've got a perfectly calibrated image that's fine to use on set. So I'm going to close that, remove some sidebar, and we're back to normal. To maintain the high quality you depend on, we're transitioning to a more sustainable business model. Video Assist 2.0 will be free to download with an optional base or pro subscription. If you purchased Video Assist 1.0, thank you for being an early adopter. You'll receive lifetime access to the features you've come to know, the equivalent of having a permanent base subscription. Professional features including LUTs, focus peaking, false color, zebras, compositing, and ProRes recording are available with a Pro subscription. And now for some details about my iPad rig. It's built around the NICI rig bracket, which has got a thicker spine than the equivalent small rig bracket, so it feels stronger in the hand. The V-Lock and the Teradek plate mount separately so that the weight is distributed on the back of a 13-inch iPad. The handles are in place to make it easy to hand hold. This rig is designed to be a portable director's monitor. It takes video in and power in and will last all day, auto-record, and allow the director to manage their own playback. All of the components are based around this 3D printed part. It made sense to design a custom bracket to fit this, as it means all the electronics are neat, organized, and tucked away. To outline the assembly process, I started with this, the NICI rig bracket with the 3D printed part bolted into it. Then all of the components come in. We have the Ugreen capture card, which is our video input via HDMI. We have an A-Logic USB-C splitter. This is required as we only have one USB-C port on the iPad Pro, and we need to connect both the USB-C capture card, and we also need to connect external power. The final component is a DTAP to USB-C power delivery box. I found that when powering directly from a V-Lock into the iPad, it would not deliver enough wattage, so I needed to use a DTAP converter so that it had the adequate amount of power delivery. This plate was designed around a V-Lock plate, so the electronics fit within and the V-Lock plate screws on top. Into the V-Lock plate I wired in a 2-pin LiMo for the Teradek. The USB-C DTAP input plugs into the bottom side of the V-Lock plate. This is what it looks like on the back. As you've seen before, this is what the final build looks like. There are many ways to build a rig and it all depends on what you want to include. You could add video out via HDMI, or you could add a HDMI to SDI converter so that you have SDI out of your iPad. You can also add an external SSD for recording. You may also want to have sound output so the director can listen to their comms. I hope you found this demo useful. Video Assist 2.0 is now available on the App Store. Download it now for free and give it a test run. I'm looking forward to hearing what you think.